is gone. All right, we get you to find a seat this morning. Praise God. Are we ready to go live? We there? All right. We want to welcome you to New Beginnings Church this morning. We're so glad that you're taking time out of, or just taking time to join us, whether it's this morning or sometime later on in the week, or who knows, in the next couple weeks, maybe it's a year from now you might be watching this. Who knows? Amen. That's the blessing of Facebook and YouTube. I also want to remind you, I probably haven't mentioned this before, but we also are uploading our Sunday morning services to YouTube, so you can find us there at New Beginnings Church Bangor on YouTube. You'll find messages there too if you like to use YouTube rather than Facebook. And so, but we're glad that you're joining us this morning. God is faithful. We're just enjoying another beautiful day here in the state of Maine. Glory to God. Yeah, been a little cool this morning, but that's all right. Like in the 40s, it felt fresh and crisp. Amen. So it was in the 40s this morning. Going to get up in the upper 80s later on in the week. Praise God. So glad that you tuned in for the weather report here in Maine this morning. Amen. We like to talk about it here because it's you never know what you're going to get. But it's been a pretty good spring and summer so far. So, hey, want to encourage you at this time, if you'd like to hit like and share, that will make what we're about to do here today available to all your friends that are on your Facebook page. Also want to remind you that you can give. If you want to be a blessing to New Beginnings Church, you can do that by going to newbeginningsbangor.org. Is that right? I got that right. newbeginningsbangor.org. Is that our website? That's right. newbeginningsbangor.org. I have to check myself every now and then. And you can give via PayPal there, or if you'd like to give by check or send cash in the mail, which we like cash. Cash is good. We'll take it all as long as it all comes in to the bank account. We're thankful for that. Amen. Glory to God. You can send a cash or a check to New Beginnings Church at 8 Molly Lane, Bangor, Maine, 04401. Amen. We are in a teaching series called What Are You Worried About? Yes. Amen. There's so many ways you can say that, isn't that right? What are you worried about? What are you worried about? We are in the book of Psalms, the book of Psalms, and we're at Psalms chapter 23, and we're teaching through Psalms chapter 23. Hope you enjoyed last week's message. If you didn't get to watch last week's message, we encourage you to go back to Facebook. You'll find it there, or absolutely, it's on YouTube also. So go with me to the book of Psalms, and we're in Psalms 23, or Psalm 23. I kind of have to correct myself with that. Psalm. We're in Psalm 23. Praise God. And remember now, last week as we begin to teach, I mentioned about as we read this, we want to read it as if God was saying it to us, not just David's account as God has inspired him to write as if it was from his perspective. Not that that's wrong. Obviously, he was inspired to write it that way, but we also want to be mindful that God is speaking to us. He's not just speaking to David. He's speaking to every one of us today. Isn't that right? He's speaking to you. Psalms 23 is to not only to David, but it's to you. Amen? And it's to me. It was written by David by the inspiration of the Spirit of the Lord, but it was written for anyone who would receive it, anyone who would who needs a shepherd in their life. And let me just say, we all need the Lord as our shepherd. Isn't that right? He's the best shepherd there ever is or ever will be. Amen? So he says here, and again, let's read the whole psalm, or I'll read the whole psalm to you as if it was the Lord writing it to us. I am the Lord, I am your shepherd, you shall not want. I make you to lie down in green pastures, I lead you beside still waters. I restore your soul. I lead you in paths of righteousness for my name's sake. Yea, though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you will fear no evil, for I am with you. My rod and my staff, they comfort you. I prepare a table for you in the presence of your enemies. I anoint your head with oil. Your cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life, and you will dwell in my house forever. You know, as you read it that way, it reads much differently because it makes it very personal, as if the Lord was speaking to you, and certainly he is. Going back to verse 1, he says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. We made reference to that what shepherd would want his sheep to be in lack? Think about that. What would you want, some scrawny-looking sheep? Come on. Right? You're the shepherd. Their care and provision for their life is absolutely dependent upon you, and the way they look and the way that they're supplied has everything to do with you. And if you're a shepherd, what shepherd would want his sheep to look like they were starving? Not any. Amen. Isn't that right? If you own sheep, that's your livelihood. Isn't that right? I mean, on an earthly sense, a shepherd raises sheep because they're his livelihood. They're gonna bring him a payoff on an earthly level, but certainly not. God is not in relationship to with us because we somehow bring him a payoff. In respect to that, we're the ones who get the payoff. Isn't that right? Amen. Praise the Lord. He is the Lord is our shepherd, and so he doesn't want us to be in want. He doesn't want us to lack anything. Praise God. Now, there are many viewpoints out there, but let me just say, I believe if you study the scripture thoroughly, you can clearly see that God is not interested in any of his sheep, sons, daughters, whatever you want, however you want to portray it. God is not interested in his sheep or children being in lack. Isn't that right? I don't know about you. When I was raising my kids, I didn't want, and now let me just say, my capacity was limited, but when my kids had a need, I didn't want my kids to have to go without. I don't know about you. I didn't want my kids to go without. And let me just say, God does not want us to go without. He wants us to know that he is there for us, that he is our supply. But we talked about this last week. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. We talked about that there's a man part to us not being in want, because as a sheep, I have to be dependent on the shepherd, and that I can't be doing my own thing. Isn't that right? I can't have an independent mindset as a sheep. I need to understand that I'm completely dependent upon him, where he leads me, where he guides me, the one who knows ahead. He knows where I'm going. He knows where I'm supposed to be. And if we get into a place of independence, as we said, like the children of Israel being led out of Egypt, they had an independent mindset. When the Lord wanted to take them into the promised land, they had their own way of thinking. Isn't that right? So before we get into this, I want us to look at Isaiah 53. Let's go with me to Isaiah 53:6. Isaiah 53:6. Isaiah 53:6 says this. So remember now, the Lord is our shepherd. That means we're what? Sheep. Isn't that right? Notice here in Isaiah 53:6, and this is a prophetic, these are prophetic passages concerning the Lord Jesus, but here in Isaiah 53:6, it's God's viewpoint of humanity. And here in verse 6 of Isaiah 53, he says this, all we, how many? All we, like sheep, have done what? Gone astray. So we can see that sheep at different times are prone to, or apt to oftentimes, go astray. Has anybody ever done that in your life? Now let me just say, I would call myself a son of God. I would call myself a sheep, but I have found myself at times in my life going astray. Now let's get a picture of what that looks like. All we like sheep have gone astray. Notice this, it says, we have turned everyone to his what? Own way. How many times have you done some things your own way? Now understand, he says, we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. The implication is we knew the way that the shepherd was going, but we turned to do our own what? Our own thing. Come on now. It never leads to anything good. As we look into this context, he says, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. Notice this, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. So when we turn to our own way rather than the way of the shepherd, it is equal to iniquity or sin. Amen?
Amen.
Error. Praise God. Now, I don't know about you. I want to enjoy all the benefits that the shepherd has for me. I want to enjoy all the supply that the shepherd has for me. But listen, if I go astray, if I choose to do things, go my own way, then I will end up eating the fruit of my own way. Isn't that right? We've all done that. Let me just say, I would say this, just on multiple levels, this can be applied in so many different levels in life. This idea of going astray and doing things your own way. This can be applied in your finances. This can be applied in your marriage. This can be applied in all relationships. Isn't that right? So how much better would our relationships, our finances, how about our health? Well, how much better would that all look if we followed, listen, the shepherd's leading? And not go astray and do things our own way. Amen. Think about it. And listen, we've all done it. But here's the good news. Even though I'm a sheep and in my past I have gone astray, that doesn't mean I have to continue to be that person. It doesn't. Now, understand, I'm not going to be perfect at it, but to whatever degree that I have in the past gone astray, whatever that looked like, amen? But moving forward, I can be a better sheep. Woo, glory to God. I want to be a better sheep. What's that mean? I'm staying close to the shepherd. Why am I staying close to the shepherd? Because I know that if I go my own way, that it's going to lead to something painful or troubling, and I'm, you know, sheep are defenseless. You know that? They have no way to defend. They don't have sharp teeth, guys. Right? They don't have claws. Sheep are defenseless. That's why they need a shepherd. I was, as I was doing some study along these lines in Psalms 23, there was a story of some shepherds that had flocks in eastern Turkey. It was, I believe it was in the early 2000s, and they were moving these sheep along, and they had stopped in a certain place, and it was near a ravine. A steep ravine, a steep drop-off, a deep ravine. And so they're in this place, and the sheep are all doing fine, but one sheep got in his mind that he was going to walk off the ravine. So that listen to what I'm about to tell you. That one sheep walked over to the ravine, walked off, 400 other sheep followed him off the ravine. Think of that. One of them went astray, and because one went astray, 400 others followed him right off the edge of the cliff. Come on now. Yeah, listen to what I'm saying here. You and I are sheep. We need to stay close to the shepherd and not be distracted with what other sheep are doing. Come on now. You keep your eyes on the shepherd. Amen. Don't get led astray by another sheep. And don't be somebody who leads others astray. Well, we're helping somebody today. Amen? Stay close to the shepherd. Because, you know, here's the picture of that. Others are watching you. Think of what I just said. How important is it for you and I to keep our eyes on the shepherd, stay in relationship with him, stay close to him? Because if we don't, others are watching. You're an influence to somebody. All we like sheep have, listen, gone astray. Everyone in this room has gone astray, not just prior to your coming into a relationship with Christ, but since you've been in relationship with Christ, you've gone astray in certain ways. That doesn't mean you went off the cliff. Praise God, you're still here. Amen. You don't have to go off a cliff. But we go astray. We do things our own way at times. And it never leads to anything good because in Isaiah 53:6, going our own way is equal to sin. In that context, if you're reading it in context there, it's equal to sin. Why? Because the shepherd's going in one way, and the way he's going, it's the right way. It's the right way. And for me to do anything other than what he's doing is error. Praise God. So we want to be good sheep. Isn't that right?
Amen.
How about you? Back to Psalms 23. We want to be good sheep. We want to stay close to the shepherd. Because the shepherd wants to keep us supplied. I like the idea of supply. There's nothing about lack that I enjoy. I don't know about you. I never enjoy not having enough. Praise God. That doesn't mean I sit, fuss, and whine and complain if I don't have enough. But what I do is I stay in faith. Isn't that right? I keep trusting the shepherd. Glory to God. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. Right? We talked about that being a metaphor for God's supply in our lives. And we put emphasis on this idea that he makes me lie down in green pastures. He has to literally work at getting us to take a break. Isn't that right? And then we talked also about that last week, about many of us living with inner tension, that we can be sitting down but not sitting down on the inside. Isn't that right? There's this inner tension. Can anybody relate to that last week, that you can live with this inner tension, like it's you're never relaxing, and God doesn't want that. He wants us to just enjoy every step of the journey that we're taking with him. He does not want us to be concerned. That inner tension, let me just say, that inner tension that we live with is attached to a way of thinking that is full of anxiety. Yeah, it gets quiet when you say things like that. Because I've seen it in my own life. When I had that inner tension going on, it was rooted in a way of thinking where I was concerned about an issue, as if I was alone, as if God wasn't involved in the situation, as if supply wasn't going to be made. And so I'm living with this inner tension, and God wants us to understand, because he's our shepherd, we need to just relax and take it easy and deal with that inner tension that you can live with. Stop it. Relax. When you find yourself in it, call it what it is. Amen? It's not trust. Whenever I'm like that, I'm not trusting. Because when you're in trust, listen to what I'm about to say, when you or I are in trust, there's rest. Whoo! I like rest. And I'm not a lazy person. I mean, I don't mind work, but I'm talking about rest. I'm talking about an inner rest. Because I'm in a place of trusting the Lord. When I get into a place of anxiety, I'm worried about me not being able to manipulate or work something out to fix it. Oh, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? I mean, living like this, inner tension. And it's not God's best for us, that he wants us to lie down in those green pastures. What's he want us to do? Rest, not just physical rest, but inner rest. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. We talked about that last week. We put much emphasis on that, the need for restoration of soul. That idea of restoring the soul, that word restore means to refresh and to repair. So the implication is that every one of us in life, our soul being our mind, will, and our emotions, we go through adversities, difficulties in life, and they begin to wear on our soul. That is our mind, our will, and we begin to have negative emotions that are going on in our world. And we need to get those issues restored or repaired. Really, those are, I would say this, the need for restoration of soul is a need to change the way you're thinking and I'm thinking, right? Because emotions are attached to thinking. Amen. If you've got negative emotions, just evaluate your thinking and you can see clearly that you've got negative thinking. Negative thinking produces negative emotions. Isn't that right? But again, we can become wounded in our souls. We go through life situations difficulties happen, somebody does you wrong, you end up carrying that in the realm of your soul, and the Lord wants you to be healed of that. We looked at multiple scriptures. We're not going back over those ones that we addressed where David was talking about soul, my soul, why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, he says, for I shall yet praise him. Yes. Amen. That we need to put our hope in God, that we can have disquieted souls. And we need to have those our souls to be refreshed and repaired, every one of us. Amen. So he restores my soul. And then it says, he leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. So if we're following the Lord, will we reach the right destination? Woo, yeah, we will. Glory to God. And let me just say, he's the one who knows what the right destination is. Now, I in my life, I've had the Lord reveal to me in seasons of my life what the right destination was, let's say geographically. But when we're talking about the right destination, it's a broader view. Does that make sense? The right destination would look like doing the right thing in every situation. How about handling situations right? Just think about relationships, because that's probably the biggest area that we need him to lead us in paths of righteousness. I like it says paths, plural, multiple paths. We're talking about many paths. We're talking about dealing with many of life's situations and circumstances, that there's a right path. Listen to what I'm saying. There's a right path. So if there's a right path, there's a wrong one. There's a right way to deal with things. Now, certainly we can always apply the word. Isn't that right? The word is always the right response. But even with that, you want to be led by the Holy Spirit, because the Bible says, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. Even with this, you want to be led by the Spirit of God, not only what to say, but how to say it and when to say it. I've said the right thing in the wrong way. Anybody else ever done that? And then you feel a little puffed up because you said the right thing, but you didn't get the result that you thought you was going to get. Isn't that right? I've done this with my wife, right? I've said the right thing to her, but it wasn't in the right way. And it comes back to me as if I said the wrong thing. Hey, well, anybody else out there like that? Come on. Right? You say the right thing in the wrong way, and it's as if you said the wrong thing. Oh, I'm helping somebody out there. You can send an offering for marriage counseling today if you'd like to. Just kidding. Amen. So, him leading us in paths of righteousness. Life is full of paths. Amen. Life is full of paths. Doing the right thing in the right situation. Isn't that right? So he leads us in paths of righteousness as a good what? Shepherd. Amen. Notice it says, for his name's sake. What does this imply? It implies it's his reputation on the line. Amen. You and I getting to the right destination is a reflection of his name. Yes. Amen? But I understand, he's not going to take responsibility for us going astray. Does that make sense? Meaning, if you choose to go your own way, that's not on the shepherd. That's on who? It's on me. He's wanting to lead us in paths of what? Righteousness. That sheep that went off the cliff, he didn't see the shepherd go that way, did he? He just chose his own way. Isn't that right? He just chose to do his own thing and led 400 other sheep with him. He might not even have thought that that's what he was going to do, but that's what he did. So our good shepherd leads us in paths of righteousness. Let me just say, every day you're going to face a need to be on the paths of righteousness. Because you're going to wake up, and there, if you're married, there's your wife. If you're a husband, there's your wife. And there's a path to walk, let me just tell you. There's a path to walk, and you better, listen. I like that. There's that word, Mike, listen. You want to do it right. So you know, I'm learning, you know, the Lord is helping me. I love that scripture in James where it says, be quick to hear. Slow to speak and slow to wrath. Man, you will find much success if you work that scripture. Isn't that right? Listen, because that's a scripture, that's a path. Are you hearing what I'm saying? He leads us in paths of righteousness. That scripture is from the words of our shepherd. Be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. That is a path to walk. That's the right path. Amen. Versus being slow to hear, quick to speak, and quick to wrath. Many of us, and in my past, I had been just the opposite of what the scripture said. I'd be slow to hear, and quick to speak, and quick to wrath. Rah! Don't laugh too much, Brother James. I'm thinking you can relate to me. All right, I'm just saying. Glory to God. Right? So there was a season of my life where I went down the wrong path relationally, especially with my wife, in respect to that. And I wasn't following the path of righteousness because I was, rather than being quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to wrath, I was slow to hear, quick to speak, and quick to wrath. Quick to wrath. Well, that would be my first response. Rather than patience. Carnal thing I was. And let me just say, I'm not all there, right? I still have moments, but I've made such progress. And you know, James, it's so fun walking on this path of righteousness. I mean, to do it right, to know that I haven't in any way spoken a word towards my wife that would cause her to be in some way offended or hurt on the inside. You know what I mean? Through my being slow to hear and quick to speak and quick to wrath. That's a path. Woo, I'm helping some folks today, or the Holy Ghost is through me. I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful that the Holy Spirit is who He is. He is the Spirit of truth, guiding us today into all truth. Glory to God. Do you love the truth today? Woo, I hope you love the truth. Amen. Because if you don't love truth, that means you love error. Most people don't think the opposite. But if you don't love truth, you love error, right? He leads me in paths of righteousness for His namesake. So it's His reputation is on the line in respect to us getting down these paths of righteousness, getting to the right destination. He takes it very personally. I also thought about this in the Old Testament. He is Jehovah Tsidkenu. He is the Lord our righteousness. Amen. So that He leads us in paths of righteousness for His namesake because it's who He is. I mean, how could He lead us down any other path? Because He is the Lord our righteousness, because He is righteous. Amen? So it's His reputation on the line. It's who He is. He will not ever lead you in the wrong way. Amen. Praise God. So He leads us in paths of righteousness for His namesake. So going back to this idea of if He's leading, that means we have to be good at what? Following. And so I want to address this. I want to look at another psalm, Psalms 32. Go with me to Psalms 32, verses 8 and 9. As we address this need to be good followers. Psalms 32, 8. It says here, I will instruct you. This, let's see it. The Lord is talking to us. He says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should what? Go. Remember we said last week that we as sheep have no sense of direction? I mean, that little sheep that I told the story about, very clear, he didn't have a clue. Isn't that right? To walk off into a ravine. It is very clear that he had no sense of what the right direction is. And let me just help us understand. Let's remind ourselves that as a sheep, and the Bible is clearly portraying us as sheep, we have no sense of direction apart from him. I can feel like as I'm, maybe it's probably nobody in this room. There's probably nobody in this room, but maybe it's somebody out there in Facebook land or on YouTube that I can feel maybe a sense of feathers getting ruffled. Isn't that right? That maybe that statement ruffles somebody's feathers. Well, the Bible says, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God, which implies you and I, if we're going to reach the right destination, we must be what? Led. I said this last week, and if we have to be led, that means you have no sense of direction apart from him. Praise God. Well, I don't know about that, Pastor. Yeah, I know. You don't know. I don't know about, yeah, I know. You don't know. And you know where you're going to end up? You're going to do things your own way. Amen. So I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will guide you with my eye. Ooh, I like that. Isn't that right? So what is the Lord saying? I'll just look in a certain direction and you'll go that way. That when my head turns, your head turns. When I look in a certain direction, you look in a certain direction. Come on, think about what the Lord said. I will guide you with my eye. Woo! Man, I don't know about you. I want to be that kind of sheep. So that the Lord just looks in a certain direction. And it's the right direction. He wants me to go in that direction. And I'm going to follow him. Notice this. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will guide you with my eye. Notice this, verse 9. Do not be like the horse or like the mule, which have no understanding, which must be harnessed with the bit and bridle, else they will not come near you. So he says, do not be like the horse or the mule. Well, has anybody ever been like a horse or a mule? Sure. Every one of us, we got horse and mule characteristics. Well, there's part of us that, let me just say, over time, I've had in my past some horse and mule characteristics. I'll be honest. Nobody else has to be. Let the pastor lead. Hallelujah. I've had some horse and mule characteristics in my life, in my past, and the Lord has had to work those out of me through this process of what the Bible calls transformation. Isn't that right? Let me just say, where you're not transformed, let me help you. Where you're not transformed, that means you're conformed. Where you're not transformed, you're conformed, and where you're not transformed, you have horse and mule mindsets. Come on. Where you're not transformed, you're conformed to the world. And let me just say, the world concerning God has a horse and mule mindset. But unfortunately, you and I, we come into the kingdom of God, into relationship with God through faith in Jesus Christ, and now our minds have to be renewed, and God has to deal with the horse and mule mindset. So that, and let's just say it this way, if this has been going right and well with you and your relationship with God, you are more and more being led by his eye. Now, to some of you, that's maybe a little troubling because you can see that you've got maybe more horse and mule mindset than you do a sheep mindset, or where he can guide you with his eye. But here's the good news. I was like that too. And let me just say, I haven't arrived completely. But the good news is I've made progress. Amen. How about you? Have you made progress? Amen. Is he able to lead you more with just looking versus just giving you a nod to go in a certain direction versus putting a bit and bridle on you? Come on. We as sheep are just to follow the shepherd. No bit, no bridle, right? Wherever he goes, I'm following. Wherever he goes, I'm following. Whereas a horse, he ain't going to do that. You're going to have to put a bit and bridle on that boy. That bit, it causes a little bit of discomfort in his mouth. And the more well-trained the horse is, the less aggressive the bit has to be. They have different types of bit. If the horse is a little ornery, they put a rough bit in his mouth. And the more he's trained and well-trained, the softer that bit is. And yet, there's still a bit. I don't want to be a horse. I'm never going to be a horse. I'm a sheep, but I can have a horse and mule mindset. Horse and mule mindsets are ways of thinking, which are what? Independent. They'll follow you as long as it seems good to them. Then all of a sudden they get in their own mind, they're just going to go their own way. Come on. Well, the scripture is telling us, don't be like the horse and mule, which is telling me I can either, it's a choice. Right? It's a choice. It's a way of thinking. Horse and mule thinking. He doesn't want us to be that way. Isn't that right? Praise God. So he leads us in paths of righteousness, but he wants to be able to lead us with just a simple look. Isn't that right? Because right, isn't this right? I mean, Jesus doesn't stand before me physically, right? Whatever way he's looking, I like this too. This is the way he sees. I love that. That if I want to know which way he's looking, I just open the word. I get his perception or his perspective. Isn't that right? I get how he sees. Amen. The eye is thinking about the way something is perceived. It's not just a physical thing, but it's also a mental perception, a seeing. What do? We see with eyes. We're also seeing we're in the realm of perception. So the Word of God is the way God sees things. Can God just lead you with His Word? Because it is the way He sees things. Amen. Back to Psalm 23. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Verse 4 says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. So this idea of the valley of the shadow of death, it has, I would say, a couple implications. It deals with certainly physical death. Isn't that right? Even for us as believers, physical death is just a moment in time. You understand that? That physical death is coming to all of us. But I like this idea of a shadow of death. If we're dealing with physical death, a shadow has no substance. Isn't that right? A shadow has no substance, and so if we're dealing with physical death for the believer, there's no substance in physical death, because all it is me slipping out of this body. Isn't that right? It's just the real me on the inside leaving this body. That's it. And I leave the body behind, and to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Isn't that right? And so, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, there will be one day that every one of us face death. But we need to understand that it's just a shadow. that it has no substance for you and I as believers. There's nothing for us to be afraid of. And yet, let me just say this concerning death. In, I believe it's 1 Corinthians 15, 26, it says that the last enemy that will be put away is death. So death is never portrayed in the scripture as a friend. Now, I'd rather stick with the Bible because some people will portray death, and I understand their perception that even physical death, it's not an ending for a believer. It's the beginning of what we would call a life without a body in eternity, so to speak. Right now, we live in time, but spiritually, when we physically, when we die, we step into a place of eternity apart from this physical body. So, again, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, death is an enemy. If the Bible calls death an enemy, it's an enemy. Now, I would say this concerning death. Everything within us, while we're here on the earth, should fight death. Because there'll be times where death, let me just say this, death is always lurking. Death is always lurking. But what we want to do is make sure that we've set our course to fulfill the number of our days. We want to live a full life. Amen. I'm not leaving this planet early. I'm not giving death permission to take me. Amen. Now, there'll be a day where I have to surrender up this body, but until I'm satisfied, till I've fulfilled what I feel my calling and purpose is here, I'm not giving death permission to take me. Some people are going, you mean you can give death permission? Well, let's understand this. If you can raise the dead, then you must have permission, you must have authority over death to some degree. Think about what I'm saying. See, most of us don't understand our authority in Christ. And because of that, we do not live out the full measure of that authority. And because of that, we oftentimes do not fulfill the measure of the days that God would want us to fulfill either. Some people leave the earth soon, too soon. Amen. So I don't want to get into that too much. But again, this idea, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, it implies also dealing with physical death, but it also has a metaphoric perspective as dealing with difficult situations. Isn't that right? Most of us will go through the valley of the shadow of death in respect to going through a dark, adverse time in our lives. Has anybody ever been there? Where you went through a difficult situation, you felt like you were going through the valley of the shadow of death, light seemed to be far from you. But in both cases, I want to bring notice to this. He says, yea, though I walk through. So whether we're dealing with physical death, I'm just going to go through it, or if I'm dealing with a difficult situation here on the earth, I can be confident that I'm going to do what? I'm going through. Now, I don't know about you, when you're in it, sometimes it just doesn't feel like you're ever going to get through. And let me just say, it's at those times that it feels the darkest. Isn't that right? That when you get in a difficult situation, you begin to have this soulish experience where everything begins to seem dark. And it feels like, listen to what I'm saying, it feels like you're never going to get through. But that's a lie. Because the Bible says that, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. So notice again this idea, the valley of the shadow of death, and it says fear no evil, it's associating with the valley of the shadow of death with evil. It's not something that's from God, because God's not evil. Isn't that right? So it's something that, if it's evil, it comes from the evil one. I think it's Ephesians. Yeah, it's Ephesians 6. I don't remember exactly the verse, but it says, therefore, having put on the whole armor of God, that you may withstand in the evil day. Having put on the whole armor of God, that you may withstand in the evil day. What's an evil day? Remember the context there in Ephesians 6 is dealing with demonic powers. An evil day comes from an evil one. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Evil's coming from the evil one. There is no evil in God. Isn't that right? But here's the good news. We're going through. Amen. We're going to get through. What is it that you may be going through today? And everybody in this room has history. Isn't that right? You can look back, having gone through the valley of the shadow of death, whatever that looked like. Certainly it's not physical death because you're still here, but you went through a difficult situation. You faced something adverse to you and it looked dark, but guess what? Did you come out? Did you come through? Does it look different on the other side? Yeah. But I tell you, when you're in the middle of it, it can be hard. And it's at that point you're not looking to feelings. It's at that point I look to the Word. Isn't that right? Because in a dark time, I'm not going to necessarily have feelings that are going to affirm this. Right? In a dark time, you're not necessarily going to have feelings that affirm that I'm coming through. In a dark time, it may feel like you're never going to come through, but that's why we have the Word of God, because this is how God sees. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. I will fear no evil. Making a choice that I'm not going to fear what's facing me. I'm not going to fear this dark time. I'm not going to fear death when it comes. Amen. The scripture says that Hebrews 2:14. Let's look there. Keep your finger. We're coming back to Psalm 23. Hebrews 2:14. 14 and 15. It says, inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise, speaking of Jesus, shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is, the devil. So at one time, the devil had the power of death, but guess what? He doesn't anymore. Isn't that right? Notice this. That he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is, the devil, notice this, and release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. So in reality, because Jesus has dealt with death and him who had the power of death, we are no longer subject to the bondage of the fear of death. Hallelujah. Amen. But many of us don't understand that. And there was a time that I didn't understand that fully. I could quote that scripture potentially. But boy, when you get into a dark valley, it's then you begin to have to walk out your faith. Does that make sense? That's where you have to come back to what the scripture says. And you begin to read Psalms 23 and begin to reaffirm that he's your shepherd, and that though you're walking through the valley of the shadow of death, you are going to come through and you don't have to fear any evil. Amen? And you remind yourself that Jesus, through his death, destroyed him who had the power of death, that is the devil. So in that dark time, you need to remind yourself of what the truth is. Because in that dark time, you're going to have feelings that are not rooted in truth. Amen. Amen. If you're looking to your feelings to see what is true, you're going to be in a bad place. Feelings are not the truth. This is the truth. You always want to hold this in higher esteem than whatever you're feeling, because these are the words of truth. Praise God. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Now notice this. Here's why he can fear no evil, because he's aware of, for you are with me. Amen. Notice that there's a direct association with the reason that David is saying that he fears no evil in this dark time that he's in the valley of the shadow of death. He understands and knows who's with him. And we said it from God's perspective, for I am with you. David's saying, for you are with me, but God's saying to us in this dark time, you don't have to fear evil because I am with you. Isn't that right? Amen. So again, I think this is another perspective that gets distorted in the valley of the shadow of death. This distorted view of, is God with me? Because when you're going through adverse times, you can have emotions as if God had left you. Why do you think Hebrews says God will never leave you nor forsake you? Why do you think the scripture says that? Why does it affirm that? Because we'll have times where we feel like he has what? Left us and forsake us. So the Lord has to reaffirm to us the truth. I, as your shepherd, I will never leave you, nor will I ever forsake you. And yet, when you go through a difficult time and an adverse time, the very thing that God says is not going to be necessarily how you feel. Come on. Let's be real. Right? So my emotions are not the measuring rod to truth. Right. Well, but I feel. Oh, yes. And we all have them. And life comes to everybody. Everybody in this room's been through the valley of the shadow of death. If the valley of the shadow of death is a metaphor for a difficult time, a difficult season of life, every one of us in this room has faced that. And in that difficult time, did you not have to remind yourself that God will never leave you nor forsake you? I did. I had to go back to what the scripture says, because there were emotions that were running through me that were quite contrary to what the scripture says. But most people, there's a lot of people, I shouldn't say, I want to be careful how I say most people, because I have nothing to measure that by. But there can be people who, when going through a difficult season, that they put more confidence in how they feel at that time. And then they don't search this out. They don't go to the Word of God and begin to find out what God says. And then they begin to exalt their feelings. And these are the ones who will begin, and again, I'm not criticizing. These are the ones who will begin to say, it feels like God is so far away. Why has God allowed this to happen? Why has God forsaken me? Well, the very thing that just came out of your mouth is the very thing he says that he didn't do. So there, you can have feelings in this valley of the shadow of death that will go completely contrary to what the truth says. And this is why it's so important for you and I to be well established in the truth and not exalt our feelings above the truth, because every one of us are going to face, have faced, and will face valleys of the shadow of death. And yet in the midst of that, we can fear no evil if we understand that he is with us. Let's think about the contrast to that. If I do not feel like he's with me, and I'm in the valley of the shadow of death, let me just say, when you're in the valley of the shadow of death, you feel like you have no control. And if you don't think he's with you, woo! I'm facing something I don't feel like I have any control of, and I don't feel like he's with me. What kind of place are you in? Mentally and emotionally. You are in a desperate and a despairing place. And let me just say, this is where people end up taking their own lives. People take their own lives in the valley of the shadow of death. They don't do, if the mountaintop is speaking of a great experience and where life feels is so good, and they're aware of this goodness on the, they're not taking their life when life is a mountaintop experience. They're taking their own life when they're in the valley of the shadow of death, when their emotions are screaming loud. And they don't realize that He is with them. And that He's ordained you to go through. I've always said this, if I've got through something, that means I must be in it. Because you can't get through unless you're in. So if I'm in something, that means I'll get through it. Whatever I'm in, I'm going to get through. Praise God. Well, let me just say, it's what God's ordained. He said, yea, though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you will fear no evil, for I am with you. Amen. Now, these are His words. Listen, those aren't my words. Those are His words. We're just only articulating perspective from a human viewpoint in the light of the Scripture. We're going, yeah, this is how this all works. Here's what the Word says, but this is how I feel, because we all can relate to that. Isn't that right? When you were in a dark time, did you not have feelings like, where's God? What's going on here? Oh, my goodness. Yeah, and you felt like that you weren't ever going to come through. But you did. Woo. But you did. And you will. Man, oh man. Man, that's encouraging to me. I don't know about you. This is why it's so important to live a faith life. So, because to live a faith life is to live a word life. That is, to live a faith life means that you're putting greater confidence in what this says above how you feel at any given time. Listen, at any given time, you put the Word above your feelings, because these are the words of our shepherd. I mean, these are His words to me, to you. You got to make them personal. I've got to make them personal. Amen? And we have to deal with our complacency and indifference. Sometimes as Christians, we can become very complacent or indifferent. And that usually complacency and indifference sets in a time of ease when things are going well. You can get complacent or indifferent and not hold the Scriptures in high esteem and begin to have a diminished value. You would never say that with your mouth. You would never say, well, I don't need the Word of God today. You'd never say that, and yet your actions and behavior would reveal indifference. You wouldn't say it with your mouth. You wouldn't say, well, I don't need the Scripture today. But in your actions, you're revealing indifference, because you're not seeking. You're not pursuing. We need to deal with that indifference in our lives. Because I need the shepherd. To know that I need the shepherd means I also know I need His words. I can't separate the shepherd from His word. There is no separation between the shepherd and His words. So to value the shepherd is to value his word. And now I really know I'm speaking and bringing some correction. Not because I know anyone here who's in that condition, but I know by the Spirit of the Lord that we can become indifferent, because I've seen it in my own life. And we want to, if we'll address the indifference that's in our lives in a certain season, and you'll address it now, then when the valley of the shadow of death comes, you won't be dealing with it from an indifferent place. you're staying on top of your game. You're not letting go the fundamentals. Amen? Amen. Praise God. Because the valley of the shadow of death is common to all men. You and I are going to face difficult situations, and one day we certainly will face death. Will come knocking on our door. But just don't open it. Amen? Yeah. Just tell death no. And even if it's persistent, keep saying no. You can't have me. With long life, he satisfies me and shows me his salvation. I will live and not die and declare the works of the Lord. I will what? Live and not die. Why does David say he'll live and not die? Because he knows he has a right to exercise authority over it. Who would say I'll live and not die unless they knew they had authority to do that? Either that or David's prideful and arrogant when he said it. I will live and not die and declare the works of God. Oh, who do you think you are? Many people would tell you, who do you think you are? That's scripture. I will live and not die and declare the works of the Lord. Who do you think you are? There's people out there watching right now saying, I can hear them saying it. Who do you think you are? What do you mean? Huh? That's scripture. Are you arguing with the truth? David said, I will live and not die and declare the works of God. You can't declare the works of God if you're dead. You have no voice. I will live and not die. That needs to be your declaration. Versus, I will die and not live. Death has come. I'm surrendering it over to death. And you need to know that death can linger for a long time. Oh, do you understand what I'm saying? You can get a sickness that is terminal, but have that sucker linger for 2 or 3 years. Oh, no, you don't, you foul thing. Get off my body in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I will live and not die and declare the works of God. I will live and not die and declare the works of God. With long life, he satisfies me and shows me his salvation. With long life, 60 years is not long life. 70 years is not long life. 80 years is not long life. Come on. We're just, you know, I understand this for some of you is going, this is different. Yeah, I know it is. I understand it's different. This is different. I know. But it's helpful. Amen?
Amen.
We need to know the stand that we can take. If the Bible says it, I will live and not die and declare the works of God, then I have a right to live and not die and declare the works of God.
Amen.
Amen. I believe God told Hezekiah that he was going to die. And all he did was roll to the wall and pray. And before Isaiah prophesied him, get your house in order, because you're dying. You're going to be dead. He rolls to the wall in his bed, prays to the Lord, and before Isaiah gets out of the courtyard, the Lord says, go back and tell Hezekiah I'm giving him 15 more years. How did he get 15 more years? He just prayed. He just what? He prayed. Well, you might get the same results with prayer, but you also could get it by just declaring what the Word of God says. You can get it by declaring what the Word of God says because your faith works. Amen. Your faith works. Your faith. We sang the song, Nothing is Impossible. Right? Well, that's what Jesus said. to the man whose son was demon-possessed? Lord, if you can help, if you can help, if you can do anything, please help us. And Jesus looked at him and said, if you can believe. The man says, if you can help. Jesus said, no, that's not the problem. The issue is with you. This is not with me. The issue is with you. If you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. How many things? All things are possible to him who believes. So living and not dying and declaring the works of God, is that possible to him who believes? If it isn't, Jesus is a liar. He said all things. Did he mean all things? Did he know what he was saying? I'm not sure Jesus knew what he was saying. When he said all, I think that was just maybe that was a grammatical error. No, he knew exactly what he was saying. Matter of fact, he said it for our benefit, knowing that it would flip some of us on our head, but some of us would take faith in it. That flips some people right on their head. But some people will go, that's what he said, I take it, I receive it. And guess what? They walk it out. Amen. Woo! Man, that tastes good to me. That tastes really good. Why? We all need to know how to walk by faith. And I can hear the cases in the mind. I can hear them. I can hear the cases in your mind. Not just in here, but I can hear cases in people's mind. They built cases. Most of your cases are out in the realm of the natural. Well, Sister Susie and Brother John. No. Thus saith the Lord. I don't care what happened to Sister Susie or Brother John. I care what this says. Amen? And I'm certainly not trying to be offensive. I'm just trying to hold this in higher esteem than what happened to Brother John or Sister Susie. Amen? So, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. So the rod and the staff, as I was doing some study in regards to some of the commentaries, some said that it's potentially one item spoken of in two different ways. Some said it would be two different items. Irregardless, David says, your rod and staff bring comfort to me. They said that the rod and staff, or the rod that the person used, was both used to protect from enemies. Those would try to attack the sheep, but it was also used to get them in line. They would reach out the stick and just kind of nudge that sheep back into line if it was getting a little bit off course. Just kind of give it a little, oh, no, I'm not, no, one, one of those, oh, no. No, it wasn't quite like that. To give him one of those, you know, like high karate. Oh. No, it wasn't one of those. It was just a gentle nudge, I'm sure. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So David said, again, I like this, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. So he understands the shepherd's there. The sheep has no protection from enemies other than the shepherd. So he knows my comfort is not in my ability. Think about what I'm about to say. My comfort is not in my ability to protect myself. Stop with that. Your ability to protect yourself is so limited. But his ability to protect you is unlimited. And that's where you need to be in faith. You need to have faith for his protection. His rod and staff, they comfort you. And if the shepherd has to reach out and get his rod and get you back in line, you ought to be thankful. Amen? That he didn't allow you to drift off and go astray. Come on, down over the cliff, you know, leading 400 other sheep. Right? Come on. So we want to be people that are easily corrected. Isn't that right? Just that gentle nudge of that rod, just coming up alongside. You feel that nudge, And, you know, they say this in regards to correction in general for children, and we'll parallel children with sheep. James Dobson studies, he talks about the importance of correction for children because when children have understanding of clear boundaries, they feel safe. But when parents give no correction, they feel insecure. Now, these are studies done by professionals in regards to that type of thing. And so we need to, David said, your rod and staff, they comfort me. If that rod is used to bring a level of correction, amen, then we want to embrace that understanding, as David said, that correction brings me comfort because now I know the boundaries. Because remember, as a sheep, you have no sense of direction. You have no business going your own way. I have no business going my own way because I'm going to get out there and you get out there ways and not have a clue where I am and wonder, how did I get here? Anybody ever been there? I'm talking about not even just on a physical level, but just you can wander off and you get into a certain place and you just wonder, how did I ever get here? Amen. Well, the shepherd knows how to get you back. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, we're going to leave off there today. I hope you received something. We're going to pick it up with verse 5. We'll finish up next week. I hope you've been encouraged today and challenged maybe in some way. You know, again, the shepherd is there. He's there to be a benefit to us, to help us. We want to work in cooperation with him. We don't want to be resistant to his will and his plans for us. We want to be good sheep, right? We want to stay close to the shepherd. Amen. We love you all and appreciate you all very much. Thanks for joining us on Facebook today. Let me remind you again, please hit like and share. Make this available to all your friends on Facebook. Enjoy the rest of your day.